Good evening. In June 1947, Elizabeth Bishop made her first recording at the invitation of the curator of the Woodberry Poetry Room. The recording, which you can listen to on our iPad in the back or online, was made by Professor Frederick C. Packard, who had a pioneering vision to create the first library of voices in the world here at Harvard to be housed at the Poetry Room. Bishop recounts in a letter to Robert Lowell a few months later, "When I was in Boston shortly after you were there, I met Jack Sweeney of the Poetry Room, who asked me to make some records. In the course of making them, he played yours, and I liked the Quaker Graveyard even more than I had before. Didn't you think it came off very well? I thought making the recording was rather fun, like a fish being angled for with that microphone, but my results were dreadful." Her self-critique was somewhat accurate. The recording has all the acoustic pleasure of listening to someone read a ransom note. Sabotaged by blandness was the slightly more euphemistic way a critic put it. We forget that for many of these early to mid-century, 20th century poets, to make a recording was often the very first experience they had of hearing their own voice, period, let alone reading a poem. It's a very humbling experience, as it will be to hear this introduction. We also sometimes forget that artists' particular temperaments intersect with their zeitgeist in different ways. Bishop happened to emerge during a period in which commercial recordings, radio broadcasts, and the poetry circuit of massive poetry readings that saw 14,000 people crowd a football stadium to hear T.S. Eliot and the rock star status of Dylan Thomas touring the country were all the rage. A time, in other words, that was somewhat antithetical to reticence, reflection, and restraint. One a little bit like ours. And still, to quote the phrase, she persisted. If you come later this year, if we all persist, we'll have on exhibit a 16-inch master disc that I want to give the credit to Mary Walker Graham for having helped find and research. It's a 16-inch master disc with the wax pencil notation, "Best Fish," on it, the superlative suggesting that many takes were needed to achieve and to catch Bishop's tremendous poem, "The Fish." The beauty of an audio archive like ours, if we can just boast for 1 minute, is that one follows a poet through their career, tracing the anatomical changes in their physical human voice as they age, the shifting origin stories, sometimes totally antithetical, they tell about specific poems as they grow more remote from their own poem's creation, and as they begin to integrate more feedback and scholarship into their own understanding of their work. The performative transformation that occur, compelled by changes in their writing style, or as they embrace the generative, impromptu, conversational possibilities of orality and this thing, the microphone. This archive shows us that the idea of a definitive recording is essentially moot, with an M-O-O-T, such that there is no single instance of a poem or a poet's voice. Likewise, in biography, especially in the hands of so adept, attentive, and honorable an author as Megan Marshall, the subject is granted evolution, is permitted slippage. Marshall at first documents a remote teacher and then pursues her through the lens of compassionate, yet always fiercely accurate research to hook, at last, no single monolithic Elizabeth. Rather, she releases us into the poet's numerousness, flowing and flown. Here to introduce our esteemed guest tonight is eminent Bishop scholar, poet, and professor at, fittingly for Bishop's birthplace, Worcester State. Please welcome Heather Treseler.
In the fall of 1976, Elizabeth Bishop taught her final verse writing class here at Harvard. The following spring, having turned 66, the required retirement age for non-tenured professors, Bishop was let go in accordance with that institutional rule, and despite the fact that she had by that year already won the National Book Award and the Pulitzer Prize and would soon complete her trifecta, winning the National Book Critics Circle Award for her last luminous collection, Geography 3. Yet, it was in that last poetry writing course that Bishop unwittingly taught her future biographer, Megan Marshall, who would before long win her own trifecta of prizes, the highly coveted Frances Parkman Prize, as well as the Mark Linton History Prize for her premier biography, The Peabody Sisters, and the Pulitzer Prize in biography for Margaret Fuller. These two astonishing books enliven the women at the literary and spiritual center of American Romanticism, recovering their roles in shaping the 19th century's cultural import, one that succeeds to our own moment. Marshall's two biographies fundamentally change the ways in which we understand the phenomenon of transcendentalism and its broader milieu, affirming Ralph Waldo Emerson's aphorism that, quote, "There is properly no history, only biography. Every mind must know the whole lesson for itself. What it does not see, what it does not live, it will not know." Marshall's biographies wed a historian's attention to fact to a novelist's skill. In her hand, archives are enlivened, personal and civic histories are interwoven, and lives led with their usual mixture of conviction and confusion are made wholly engaging to the reader, so that he or she, in the words of Emerson, comes to live and know the dimensions of a particular history and selfhood anew. In Elizabeth Bishop, A Miracle for Breakfast, Marshall steps into the 20th century to give us a much needed portrait of the American poet whose canonical place in poetics has grown almost arithmetically since her death in 1979. In Marshall's account, we encounter Bishop as the precocious child navigating hitherto unknown traumas after her father's death and mother's institutionalization. A clever adolescent who would hitchhike and sleep in the Natick woods to avoid a mixer party with boys. And the Vassar College graduate weathering love affairs and betrayals as she sought a person and a place in which her poetry could find a sustaining home. Marshall is the first of Bishop's biographers to make judicious use of a cachet of intimate letters discovered in 2009, which include Bishop's correspondence with her psychiatrist, Dr. Ruth Foster, and three lovers. Collectively, they provide a portal into the ambition and addiction, desire and desperation, artistry and psychotherapeutic healing that were the north and south of Bishop's experiences. Never has Bishop's affair with Alice Smith Fessel, her saving grace, been sketched in such compelling detail, nor the context of the late poems One Art, Five Flights Up, and Sonnet so clearly established. What emerges from Marshall's careful telling is the embodied context of Bishop's great poems, a portrait of a writer as troubled and as tempted as any other, a perfectionist who would write one of the best villanelles in the English language, who also enjoyed playing ping pong and making love first thing in the morning. By itself, A Miracle for Breakfast would be a superb biography of one of America's best poets. But Marshall adds something else. Reversing the traditional posture of the biographer, wherein identification with the subject is wholly obscured or kept off stage, Marshall also tells the tale of her own life as it intersected with Bishop's in the late 1970s. In brief chapters of memoir, Marshall describes her arrival in Cambridge, where she found a drafty room on River Street and a job in the Harvard admissions department before taking a place as a student in the classrooms of Robert Lowell, Robert Fitzgerald, and Elizabeth Bishop, stepping definitively toward her future career. With delicacy, Marshall traces parallels and experiences she shared with Bishop to include dealing with a mentally ill parent, negotiating the class and gender hierarchies of an Ivy League university, navigating the archetypal space allowed a woman writer, and honing the powers of observation and narration that would earn both poet and biographer an enduring place in American letters. The result is a remarkable book in which the biographer's relationship with her subject, in life and the memory of it, is brought wholly alive for her readers redoubled pleasure. Marshall is the Charles Wesley Emerson College Professor, a Harvard University and Radcliffe Institute alumna, and she joins us here this evening.
Oh. Thank you, Heather. That was, I'm sure, the best introduction I'll ever have. Wonderful, and thank you, Christina Davis, the director of the Woodberry Poetry Room, and also Mary Graham, who really helped put together this evening, also of the Woodberry Poetry Room. It's so meaningful to me to be here in the Houghton Library, where I spent so much time researching the earlier books. For me, Widener and Houghton and the Woodberry Poetry Room are sort of the trinity of places at Harvard, and you know, it's. I'm so happy to be here and happy to have all of you here. I'm going to try to talk mostly about the work on the book, some kind of behind the scenes thing, but I will read a little passage as well, so you can see how some of the research played into and thinking played into the development of a certain episode. But really, you know, why this book? When I was a student at Harvard and I was in the classes of these eminences, I was never their friend. But as I came to the process of writing biographies after that, I began to think that those days in the classes of Robert Lowell, Elizabeth Bishop, the famous ones, the ones we had come here to study with if we were lucky enough to get into their classes, kind of set me up for biography. You were close to this person, but not really a friend, the way a biographer is with their subject. And so it occurred to me after finishing the Margaret Fuller that maybe now was the time to write about Elizabeth Bishop, who I was very lucky to be in the presence of in her class, a woman poet. This was unusual. I was able to figure out that she was the first woman poet to teach an advanced creative writing class at Harvard, and the first woman poet to have her own name listed in the course catalog. That was extraordinary, not the sort of thing she wanted to be known for. She didn't like to be known as a woman poet. But for me, in the 1970s, and for the women who were lucky to be in her classes, that was an exciting thing. So I thought, well, maybe I'll write something more like an appreciation. My field was 19th century. How was I going to, you know, why would I write a full biography? But being kind of the library rat that I am, I started poking around in the archives and found, as Heather described, this amazing trove of letters from that had emerged. They didn't actually get to the archive, I think, until about 2011, and it was 2013 that I started this project. She's described those letters a bit. But some of the other things that started to happen, actually came from a Woodberry Poetry Room recording, which we'll play a little clip from this. I had come across the program for Elizabeth Bishop's memorial service, and this is really kind of humbling about what can the historian or biographer really know. So there was the program. I thought I knew what had happened at the memorial service, but then when I listened to the recording, which happens to be on the Woodberry Poetry Room website, I heard this little thing, which Christina, maybe you can try to play for me, and this is sort of what told me there's more here, more than meets the eye.
Mr. Ashbury doesn't seem to be here, so I guess we can just move along to Robert.
I'm sorry to be advanced in this way.
So, if you'd read the program, you would see that John Ashbery read first at Elizabeth Bishop's memorial service. He was really the star poet of that year, 1979. He'd won all these prizes for his self-portrait in a convex mirror, and of course he should speak first, but he wasn't there. He wasn't there on time. And that, you know, sort of, that it's that kind of thing that, you know, makes me start, the creative world wheels begin to spin. He did get there, and the poem that he read was Elizabeth Bishop's first Sestina, A Miracle for Breakfast. Sorry, is this something that I, that's important? No, I'll put that away, okay. I keep knocking into it. A Miracle for Breakfast, and I loved that title, and he loved that poem. It inspired him to write his first Sestina. It was a form that wasn't really all that much practiced at the time that Elizabeth Bishop took it up in the mid-1930s, and this is one of her early publications, her first publication in Poetry magazine. A Sestina is a old French form, quite rigorous, of a poem of six stanzas, six lines each, and the end words of the first six lines are repeated as end words in a specific pattern throughout the next six stanzas. And it's really a kind of tour de force to accomplish this. Ashbery said that he, this poem that he wrote, his own Sestina, was the first one that he liked enough to keep. This was during his Harvard student days. And I loved, what I loved about the title, though, was this kind of, it captured a, I don't know, upbeat is maybe not quite the right word for Elizabeth Bishop, but one of her favorite lines comes at the end of a poem she wrote in her late 30s, facing a birthday when she was feeling kind of depressed, and she wrote this poem called The Bite, and the last lines are all this, it was about a inlet, a sort of harbor at Key West. All the untidy activity continues, awful but cheerful. And this was kind of her, I don't know, if she wanted to, her mission statement, you might say, the world, things might be awful, but she would attempt to remain cheerful. And sometimes the poems had this effect for her. They were what enabled the cheerful side of her. And I wanted that in the title of my book. And it was also a very crucial poem, although I don't know that anyone would say it was her best poem or necessarily even a major poem, but she was working on it at a time when she was quite young, in her mid to late 20s. She'd had some success as a poet, but she wasn't someone who wrote very fluently. She wasn't like Robert Lowell later, you know, writing sonnets every day. It was painful and difficult and uncertain. And she turned to her mentor, Marion Moore, an eminent female poet of an earlier generation, and said, "What do you think? Do I have the capability to be a poet, or should I give up and go to medical school," as she was planning to do, had written away for applications. And Marion Moore said, "You know, I don't think you'd be happy. You should probably be a fine doctor, but I don't think you would be happy as a doctor. You should follow this skill," which she, you know, very much supported. And then as a result, at this very moment, this is when Bishop finished A Miracle for Breakfast and sent it to Marion Moore, and even had kind of the strength to defy some of Marion Moore's advice about the poem. She didn't like some of the end words, Moore didn't, and some of the lines, but Elizabeth Bishop stood her ground and kept the poem more or less the way it was. So it's a defining poem in that way. And I also began to realize, as I looked more closely, that each of these six end words would make ideal chapter titles for me. And they were balcony, crumb, coffee, river, miracle, and sun. And they sort of strung her life together on a chronological vector. And that became a kind of I don't know, almost a word puzzle for me as I was working through the book. And when you read it, you'll find the ways that these words kind of define certain epochs in her life. Balcony, the first chapter, she's on the brink of things. I won't tell you about all the others. I'll let you be surprised by that. But I still, once the book was expanding, I still felt it would be most honest to really keep myself in it in some way. I couldn't write about someone I'd known without making that clear. And I came up with a plan of interspersing these six Sestina chapters with memoir passages from my own life. I wasn't trying to say that I was anything like Elizabeth Bishop's equal. In fact, quite the opposite. I was posing myself as a young person, as an aspirant. But I think they function to give the reader a sense of contact with Elizabeth Bishop. If I was there with her, there's a little plot that strings through it, my dealings with Miss Bishop, as we called her. And that provides, I think, a bit of almost comic relief in contrast to a life, Bishop's life, that was so often marked with loss and dislocation, despite the poems that allowed her to float above all that. I posed myself as a learner of poetry. There's a lot of poetry in this book, not always Bishop's, sometimes the poems that we were studying in class. And then, as Heather mentioned, what is it like for a biographer, not even a biographer who necessarily knows their subject, to be in such close proximity with one person for so much time? Something has happened to me every time, and biographers always say this, you choose a subject just kind of instinctively, and then the more you work on it, the more you find that you've got, you know, odd things in common. And here's one odd thing I discovered early on, we'll move to another slide. Here you see Elizabeth Bishop along, this is her favorite portrait of herself. And this is a picture of me the summer after I had met her in Robert Lowell's class. I hadn't seen that photograph of Elizabeth Bishop, but there I was wearing the same shirt and against a rock wall, the sleeves were rolled. It just gave me this kind of eerie feeling. And there were a number of things like that that just kept happening. You'll sense some of those as you read through those memoir sections. So the first poem of Elizabeth Bishop's that I knew was the one that she read when she came to Robert Lowell's class in the spring of 1975. He was having a difficult semester, and she came, I think, to help out, to support him. He did, in fact, miss some classes because he was unwell. And we luckily have a recording of Elizabeth Bishop reading this poem that is simply called Poem. And I'll read just a paragraph from my book that introduces the poem. I don't quote the whole poem in the book, but the class was held on the ninth floor conference room of what was then called Holyoke Center. I think it's now called the Smith Center, Campus Center. Kind of an odd place to have a poetry workshop. It was, you know, an administration building at the time, but there we were. So on an April afternoon, I entered the classroom to find a small older woman with short, stiff white hair, clad in an elegant light wool suit and carrying a thin black binder, taking a seat across the conference table from mine. Professor Lowell introduced his friend, Elizabeth Bishop. Miss Bishop, he purred in his southern-tinged Boston Brahmin drawl. Now it was our guest's turn to read. She smiled obligingly, somehow both coy and businesslike, and took a sheaf of photocopies out of her binder, handing around Poem, as it had appeared in the New Yorker several years before. I'll just have to stop for a second to say that the effect of this poem on me was very much like what she described when she first read Marianne Moore's poem. She said, I hadn't known poetry could be like that. Why had no one ever written about things in this clear and dazzling way before? The scene poem evoked contrasted strikingly with the cityscape captured in the picture windows behind the writer's bowed head as she leaned over the page. Harvard's brick dormitory rooftops, the campanile of St. Paul's Church. And now you can hear Elizabeth Bishop read poem.
And this same man, he became a painter in France and England, and he came back to visit his sister, my grandmother, and before I was born. And I fell heir to a very small painting of his, and this poem, which is about 30 years newer than the last one, was written about that picture. It's just called Poem. About the size of an old-style dollar bill, American or Canadian, mostly the same whites, gray-greens, and steel-grays. This little painting, a sketch for a larger one, has never earned any money in its life. Useless and free, it has spent 70 years as a minor family relic, handed along collaterally to owners who looked at it sometimes or didn't bother to. It must be Nova Scotia. Only there does one see gabled wooden houses painted that awful shade of brown. The other houses, the bits that show, are white. Elm trees, low hills, a thin church steeple, that gray-blue wisp, or is it? In the foreground, a water meadow with some tiny cows, two brush strokes each, but confidently cows. Two minuscule white geese in the blue water, back to back, feeding, and a slanting stick. Up closer, a wild iris, white and yellow, fresh squiggle from the tube. The air was fresh and cold, cold early spring, clear as gray glass. A half inch of blue sky below the steel gray storm clouds. They were the artist's specialty. A speck-like bird is flying to the left. Or is it a fly speck looking like a bird? Heavens, I recognize the place. I know it. It's behind, I can almost remember the farmer's name. His barn backed on that meadow. There it is, titanium white, one dab. The hint of steeple, filaments of brush hairs, barely there, must be the Presbyterian church. Would that be Miss Gillespie's house? Those particular geese and cows are naturally before my time. A sketch done in an hour, in one breath, once taken from a trunk and handed over. Would you like this? I'll probably never have room to hang these things again. Your Uncle George, no, mine, my Uncle George, he'd be your great uncle, left them all with Mother when he went back to England. You know, he was quite famous, an R.A. I never knew him. We both knew this place, apparently, this literal small backwater. Looked at it long enough to memorize it our years apart. How strange. And it's still loved, or its memory is. It must have changed a lot. Our visions coincided. Visions is too serious a word. Our looks. Two looks. Art copying from life and life itself. Life and the memory of it so compressed they've turned into each other. Which is which? Life and the memory of it cramped, dim on a piece of Bristol board. Dim, but how alive, how touching in detail. The little that we get for free, a little of our earthly trust, not much. About the size of our abundance along with theirs, the munching cows, the iris crisp and shivering, the water still standing from spring freshets, the yet-to-be-dismantled elms, the geese.
So, Life and the Memory of It, one of her most famous lines in the title of the first biography written, or the first major biography of Bishop, published in 1992. So I was lucky to find the painting that the poem is based on, and you're looking at it right now. It's bigger, a lot bigger on the screen. It is quite small, only about this size. And Elizabeth Bishop was also herself a pretty talented painter. Here's her own vision of a rather similar scene, and that's the church steeple. So you really get a sense from looking at the painting and also her own painting that, you know, they were standing there looking at the same place many years apart. It's quite astonishing what you can find out when you start looking into things. I want to play one more poem that was the poem that I most loved when I began working on this biography, and I think maybe you'll understand why. It really spans her whole life in a certain way, although it's primarily a recollection of childhood, called In the Waiting Room. I learned that this was a poem, I think it was published perhaps around 1972 in the New Yorker, 71. Thanks, that's Lloyd Schwartz, my prompter. He knows all. Wonderful editor of Bishop's work and a great poet and critic. Anyway, so 1971, it wasn't published in a book until the 1976 Geography 3. Shortly after it came out, people loved this poem, and Bishop's friend Mae Swenson asked if she would contribute this poem to a volume that was to be called The Women Poets in English. It was going to be very authoritative, and they really had to have something by Elizabeth Bishop, and you'll hear in the poem why Mae Swenson might have thought this would be particularly relevant, because it appears to be, in many ways, is about growing up, about becoming or facing the rude fact as a little girl that you might have to become a woman. But Elizabeth Bishop was, you know, very averse to being identified as a woman poet. She said no, and I think in her answer to Mae Swenson, when she said she wouldn't be in this volume, you hear also what's great about this poem. It's not only about a girl becoming a woman, it's about everyone falling into consciousness, into the awareness of adulthood, and much more. I'm not here to tell you what the poem is about, but here's what she wrote to May, who said, you know, you really should be in the women poets in English. Elizabeth says, well, why not men poets in English? Don't you see how silly it is? I like black and white, yellow and red, young and old, rich and poor, and male and female, all mixed up. Literature is literature, no matter who produces it. So let's have In the Waiting Room.
This poem is called In the Waiting Room. In Worcester, Massachusetts, I went with Aunt Consuelo to keep her dentist's appointment. Sat and waited for her in the dentist's waiting room. It was winter. It got dark early. The waiting room was full of grown-up people, arctics and overcoats, lamps and magazines. My aunt was inside what seemed like a long time, and while I waited, I read the National Geographic. I could read, and carefully studied the photographs. The inside of a volcano, black and full of ashes. Then it was spilling over in rivulets of fire. Osa and Martin Johnson dressed in riding breeches, laced boots, and pith helmets. A dead man slung on a pole. Long pig, the caption said. Babies with pointed heads wound round and round with string. Black, naked women with necks wound round and round with wire like the necks of light bulbs. Their breasts were horrifying. I read it right straight through. I was too shy to stop. And then I looked at the cover, the yellow margins, the date. Suddenly, from inside came an oh of pain, Aunt Consuelo's voice. Not very loud or long. I wasn't at all surprised. Even then, I knew she was a foolish, timid woman. I might have been embarrassed, but wasn't. What took me completely by surprise was that it was me, my voice, in my mouth, Without thinking at all, I was my foolish aunt. We were falling, our eyes glued to the cover of the National Geographic, February 1918. I said to myself, 3 days and you'll be 7 years old. I was saying it to stop the sensation of falling off the round, turning world into cold, blue-black space. But I felt you are an I, you are an Elizabeth, you're one of them. Why should you be one, too? I scarcely dared to look to see what it was I was. I gave a sidelong glance. I couldn't look any higher. Its shadowy gray knees, trousers and skirts, and boots, and different pairs of hands lying under the lamps. I knew that nothing stranger had ever happened. Nothing stranger could ever happen. Why should I be my aunt, or me, or anyone? What similarities, boots, hands, the family voice I felt in my throat, or even the National Geographic and those awful hanging breasts held us all together or made us all just one? How, I didn't know any word for it, how unlikely. How had I come to be here like them and overhear a cry of pain that could have got loud and worse, but hadn't? The waiting room was bright and too hot. It was sliding beneath the big black wave, another and another. Then I was back in it. The war was on. Outside in Worcester, Massachusetts, were night and slush and cold, and it was still the 5th of February, 1918.
So, as was true of many of Elizabeth Bishop's poems, they were based in scenes or visions, moments that she worked over in her mind in different ways, sometimes writing drafts, early drafts, and not finishing for 20 years. This scene of in the waiting room was one that she wrote about first in a story that she didn't publish called The Country Mouse, work that she was working on in the late 1950s, or may have finished around 1961, I think Lloyd says in his book of her prose. So, this was after she'd been living in Brazil for about almost 10 years with Lada de Macedo Soares, her very precipitate and pragmatical lover, and in kind of tropical splendor with a studio all to her own. Things weren't necessarily going as well as they had at the beginning, however, by this time, and somehow, and I'll talk about this later, this scene recurred to her of the time when she had been, you know, in the waiting room. It could be anyone in that waiting room having this realization, being part of the human community. But in fact, in her life, that waiting room scene, as she was about to turn 7, took place after probably the most traumatic experience in her life so far. She had lived with her mother's family in a small town in Nova Scotia after her father's death when she was 8 months old, and she'd become very close to her grandparents as her mother declined and ultimately was institutionalized for mental illness. And then once her mother appeared never to be coming back, the Worcester Bishop grandparents came and, as she wrote in The Country Mouse, kidnapped her. It felt like being kidnapped, being taken away from the home that she had known and to Worcester. And I think that this poem, and you can tell, or this moment in the story of the Country Mouse about being in the waiting room, waiting for her foolish aunt, the feelings are much more raw in the story. She talks about having a feeling of absolute and utter desolation. Her question is, why was I a human being? Why would it be one of them too, instead of in the poem that she later writes, there's different emphases on these questions and less of the feeling of absolute and utter desolation, although there's still a certain terror to the moment. So that is one moment that the poem touches on for me as the biographer. Then I learned through some of these letters that were new exactly when she was working on it. Another time she was working on it, that was in the summer of 1967. She had pretty much a complete draft by then. This was a time when the relationship with Lotta was really very much on the skids. They were living separately. Lotta had become increasingly obsessed with her construction project. She was working on an immense city planning, really a transformation of the waterfront in Rio, but Lotta's own demons were taking over. She'd had a breakdown. There were infidelities on Elizabeth's part, and the psychoanalyst that they both saw had ordered them to live apart for a while. But they still loved each other very much, and from New York City, where Elizabeth was, she sent Lotta a draft of In the Waiting Room, and Lotta responded saying how much she wished she'd known her as a little girl, saying that they would have to make how little time they had really had in their lives together, and they would have to make the most of the time they had left, which turned out to be only a matter of months before Lotta died of a drug overdose. She finished the poem. She didn't send it off until 1970, when she had gone through yet another kind of initially restorative relationship with a younger woman that had broken up, again, the result of mental illness on the part of Bishop's lover. She was living alone in Brazil, and that's when she finished this poem, a time when she was alone but able to say, you know, maybe this was the time she could really face the loss of Lotta. But it's fascinating to me that this poem really came into its own when she was facing a loss of home, yet again, loss of the home, only home that she'd really known for an extended period of time, the home that she'd shared with Lotta. So while I was in the archive at Vassar, some of these images are new and some of them aren't. And this, well, you'll see, kind of relates to In the Waiting Room, but also to other poems. I learned that Elizabeth Bishop, aside from being a talented watercolorist, was also a serious photographer. She thought of her work as somewhat in the vein of Cartier-Bresson, and you'll see a couple of images that will convince you of that. Bresson's notion was of the decisive moment. He traveled around the world photographing all sorts of people and trying to capture this moment. So I found these two images that just really, you know, puzzled me and interested me. This is, maybe I'll show you this one first. This is one of Bishop's own photographs with the Cartier-Bresson style, I think. Look at this, the gazes of these two women that we're seeing, one with clothes, one without. One, of course, this sort of reminds me of the, well, it's interesting, actually, in the first draft of In the Waiting Room, they weren't awful hanging breasts. They were breasts that filled me with awe. So that's something to think about, too. But I somehow, both of these pictures caught my eye. Who were these people and why was Elizabeth? This is a snapshot from in front of her, a studio in Samambaia. Who were these people? I don't know if anyone... It's kind of a not a very clear photograph, but I didn't know who they were. They weren't identified. And as I began to look into more about Elizabeth's Brazil years, I learned that these were a couple. Aldous Huxley, the author of one of the books that's now hit the bestseller list, Brave New World, and his a bit younger new wife, Laura Archera, who I read in a draft of an article that Elizabeth Bishop wrote for The New Yorker about a trip she took with the two of them. She had known Laura Archera as when she was in Key West before moving to Brazil and meeting Lotta. So I'm going to read you just a short passage. I guess I should also show you this one more picture. Since we have In the Waiting Room in mind. This was Elizabeth about the age she would have been when she had the waiting room experience. So you can think about that and then think about this and the National Geographics and this couple, the mysterious couple. So I'm going to read a little bit from the book, and you'll see what I was able to learn about the Huxleys and Elizabeth Bishop, some of the new material in my book. Elizabeth had failed so far at every attempt to write the kind of literary travel piece that was a staple at the New Yorker. This is in the beginning of the chapter called River. The chapter called Coffee is about falling in love in Brazil, and it was very coffee-like. But River, she hadn't been able to get to a river until things were actually going a little less well, flowing in another direction. So she'd failed with these previous attempts to write a fact piece, a travel piece for the New Yorker. Finally, she would be forced to admit, I'm not a journalist. But in the meantime, there was serious money to be made in prose, in contrast to the few dollars per line she earned for poetry, and Elizabeth knew how to capture Catherine White's interest with a proposal letter. Catherine was her editor for prose, wife of E.B. White. She'd spent months that stretched to years drafting and redrafting an account of a 1951 voyage to Sable Island, a desolate 25-mile crescent of sand dunes and beach grass lodged in the Atlantic between Nova Scotia and Newfoundland, known as the Graveyard of the Grand Banks, a place that has haunted my imagination most of my life, with its race of wild ponies, its unique Sable Island sparrow, the ornithologist's delight, and wonderful ghost stories of shipwrecked sailors. Elizabeth's own great-grandfather had gone down with all hands on a West Indies schooner off Sable Island's shores. Her idea to combine personal reminiscences with the best parts of the island's history, plus a first-hand account of it now, seemed a surefire plan. And as late as 1956, Catherine White still hoped to receive the article, along with several other projected fact pieces Elizabeth had suggested on locations in Brazil. That's what nonfiction reporting was called, fact pieces in the New Yorker. Eventually, Mrs. White stopped asking about Sable Island. Yet now, in August 1958, Elizabeth was flying off in a Brazilian Air Force DC-3 with the celebrated British novelist Aldous Huxley, a denizen of Hollywood since the 1930s, and his younger Italian wife, Laura Archera, to explore a remote Indian post on the Xingu River after several days spent touring the new capital city of Brasilia, with the aim of writing up the trip for the New Yorker as a combination travel piece and profile. Lotta's fortune was tied to her Samambaia properties, and Elizabeth believed it was up to me to earn a lot of $6 signs somehow, as inflation, fueled by government instability, drove the price of necessities in Brazil ever higher. Lotta and Elizabeth deplored the relocation of the nation's capital from nearby Rio to Brasilia, a modernist city of Oz, created from scratch, out of previously uninhabited jungle lands in the country's interior, not least for its diversion of enormous sums to the quixotic scheme. Still, when invited to join the Huxleys on a tour sponsored by the Brazilian government, Elizabeth had accepted. Trailing the aging author of Brave New World through the spare beginnings of the planned city, the green-tinted Ray-Ban glass panels scarcely in place on the first of Oscar Niemeyer's sleek public buildings, followed by a meeting with the Yawalapiti, a tribe under government protection from missionaries, land speculators, etc., as Elizabeth wrote Mae Swenson on her return, would surely yield marketable copy. Huxley was enjoying a new wave of fame since the 1954 publication of Doors of Perception, his record of a refulgent California afternoon on mescaline, a hallucinogenic compound found in the peyote cactus used in religious rituals by certain tribes in the American Southwest. William Maxwell, taking over as Elizabeth's prose editor from Catherine White, who had recently retired to full-time residence in Maine, telegraphed his boss, William Shawn's, instructions to go ahead with the Brasilia piece, with the caveat that we can't be sure it will work. The Air Force transport, retrofitted with blue plush seats, bore its rather highbrow passengers northwest over the River of Souls and the River of the Dead to a branch of the Xingu, if you have a map, Elizabeth wrote to Mae Swenson, describing my best trip in Brazil so far. There, a village of thatched huts rushed to meet us as the plane landed on a small strip of asphalt in the jungle, not the green Amazonian jungle, just immense wastelands with palms and small rivers, where, Elizabeth soon observed, the Iwalapitis swim and fish off and on all day. They are very clean. Aldous Huxley had been a frustrating companion and interview subject. Elizabeth later complained to Bill Maxwell, speaking only of mescaline at any length. Medicine, mysticism, and God are his present themes, she wrote to Cal Lowell. But she knew Laura Archera, a documentary filmmaker and lay psychotherapist from Key West days. Laura had been the lover of Pauline Hemingway's sister, Ginny Pfeiffer, before marrying the widowed Huxley in 1956. Elizabeth herself had been attracted to Ginny, with whom she'd spent a 10-day vacation in Haiti in 1949, easing her loneliness after the breakup with Marjorie Stevens, her long-term lover in Key West. Lotta and Elizabeth entertained the Huxleys at Samambaia in the Brazilian winter of 1958 when they first arrived, and now Elizabeth and Laura, two friends who had once loved the same woman, mingled with the Indians, all quite naked except for strings of beads. The rounded behinds and childishly smooth legs in both sexes are remarkably pretty, Elizabeth wrote in her draft for The New Yorker. We'll just move along. Laura had brought along a Polaroid camera, perhaps the same one Ginny Pfeiffer, Laura's partner in filmmaking, had purchased for the Haiti trip, and it proved an immediate attraction. Elizabeth took her own photos of Laura as she worked, a small, trim, northern Italian blonde in stylishly draped slacks among the dark-haired indigenous Brazilians. Later, on the riverbank, while some in the tour group swam, the tall, pale, and thin Aldous Huxley, strikingly handsome with well-modeled features, pulled a magnifying glass from his pocket and leaned over from his great height to examine a mass of pale yellow sulfur butterflies quivering in the wet mud at the river's edge, like the start of a yacht race, Elizabeth wrote in her New Yorker draft. The party toured a manioc patch, a half mile from the village, the tribe's only attempt at agriculture, they were informed by the Cambridge University graduate student who served as guide to this most primitive people left in the world, except for Africa's pygmies. The Iwalapiti do no work at all as we consider work, he told them, though fishing done with bow and arrow in the flowing waist-deep Zingu was a refined art they rarely miss. Inside a longhouse where men swayed in hammocks and women worked with manioc in clay pots on the dirt floor, the tourists were besieged with requests for cigarettes. Elizabeth obliged by giving each man a cigarette from her own pack and lighting it. At the far end of the shelter, hidden by a fence of twigs and palm leaves, a young girl was held in isolation, required to remain silent and invisible for a months-long puberty ritual. Elizabeth was invited to peer through the fence. This isn't the really secret part, the guide explained. So you can see why these experiences might have cast her mind back to that waiting room time when she was, in effect, going through a kind of ritual transition into awareness of adulthood. After a siesta, followed by a wrestling match with no declared winners or losers, they are gentle with each other, the travelers departed for the airstrip, but not before a Iwalapiti widower, fascinated by Elizabeth's earrings and watch, inquired whether she was unmarried. Would she stay behind to wed him? This produced a great deal of tribal merriment, Elizabeth wrote in her New Yorker draft, wryly working in a quotation from Othello. Although I was vain of having been singled out, I was afraid he merely did not want to be the Indian who threw away the pearl richer than all his tribe. Laura Archera may have taken this moment to confide in Elizabeth the fact that her own marriage to a widower had been nearly as precipitate, the ceremony performed on a whim at a roadside chapel in Yuma, Arizona. The newlywed Huxleys took up residence in the Hollywood Hills in a house a few hundred yards up the road from the one Laura had shared for years with Ginny Pfeiffer, the two households becoming one family, including two young children Ginny adopted in the early 1950s. Certainly both Lotta and Elizabeth took note of the Huxleys' arrangement. It was a model they would soon follow when Mary Morse, Lotta's former lover who'd stayed in Brazil, gave up on men and determined to adopt the babies she longed to raise. So both of these households were very free-form, innovative, new households, same-sex couples adopting children. What killed the piece for The New Yorker were the passages on Brasilia. This time, Elizabeth composed and delivered her travelogue within 2 months of the journey, but she had trouble rendering the ingenious swooping pillars of Niemeyer's futuristic Palace of the Dawn. The labored architectural descriptions stalled the narrative. After that, everything tails off badly, Bill Maxwell wrote, reporting the factual department editor's verdict, and as Elizabeth had feared, Huxley doesn't come through. She had been no more able to penetrate this famous writer's reserve than she had Frost's or Sandburg's in her days as reluctant Library of Congress doyenne. She had tried to, essentially the poet laureate, actually, they now call it, had tried to get them together, but they sat on opposite ends of the couch, wouldn't speak. But in the end, Elizabeth scarcely minded the loss of money and time and felt only rather dumb to have worked so hard again on something outside my natural bent. I'm sure many of you writers have experienced that feeling. As she wrote to May, she'd gotten a poem out of the experience, a long one, The Riverman, her first in 2 years. What a relief to begin again. And of course, she was also beginning again on this story, The Country Mouse, that I think calls up a scene like this. So I'm going to end with just one last clip from a poem and a couple of images, more of Elizabeth's photography. One of my other favorite poems is Santarem. And although here's an image taken on a river trip, not the same river trip that she describes in the poem Santarem, which was on the Amazon, where she'll tell you in the introduction to the poem, two rivers converge. This was a later trip on the Rio São Francisco in 1967, but I think it really shows you her great eye as a photographer as well as a poet. And here's another set of photos that she took of, she was always drawn to the appearance of nuns. There's some nuns in Santarem. We're not gonna hear the whole poem, but she loved these, felt these photographs were very successful and sent them to Robert Lowell to see how he would like them as well. So let's, we'll conclude with this, just the beginning of Santarem, another great poem by Elizabeth Bishop.
I'm going to read one more poem. This is about Brazil, and it's called Santarem, which is the name of a small city about two-thirds of the way down the Amazon, I think. And I've been asked what the name means, and I'm sorry to say I don't know. It's named for, as so many places in Brazil are, for a city in Portugal, a town in Portugal. And I should have looked that up, but I don't know. Of course, I may be remembering it all wrong after how many years. That golden evening, I really wanted to go no farther. More than anything else, I wanted to stay a while in that conflux of two great rivers, Tapajós, Amazon, grandly, silently flowing east. Suddenly there had been houses, people, and lots of mongrel river boats skittering back and forth under a sky of gorgeous, underlit clouds, with everything gilded, burnished along one side, and everything bright, cheerful, casual, or so it looked. I liked the place. I liked the idea of the place. Two rivers. Hadn't two rivers sprung from the Garden of Eden? No, that was four, and they had diverged. Here only two, and coming together. Even if one were tempted to literary interpretations, such as life, death, right, wrong, male, female. Such notions would have dissolved straight off in that watery, dazzling dialectic.
Okay. She liked the place and the idea of the place. She liked life and the memory of it. Anyway, thank you for coming, and that's my presentation. I'm happy to have questions if you'd like. We have a microphone for questions. So we can record the silence. Let's see. Yeah, here we have one. Thank you.
Thank you for that. It was really so fascinating. And part of the, I think maybe the nicest part of it is to hear the warmth in your voice about her. And
well, thank you.
You knew her a little, but you probably felt like you got to know her much better in the course of writing the book. So I wondered if there was anything you wanted to share about ways that your idea of her changed while you were writing the book.
Mm. Well, you know, one of the things I guess I felt was that in the class, she began our first class by saying she didn't believe poetry could be taught. And it was a little dispiriting to hear that, but I always felt there was something behind it. What it was, I wasn't sure. I respected her for being honest, for one thing. And I had the feeling that this was, you know, poetry had to be, it didn't take place in the classroom. She wasn't one of these poets who lived her life always in the academic setting, as so many poets now seem to need to do, not just seem to, must, in order to survive. And so I took this to heart, and I would say, in a certain way, the whole process of researching and learning this book was learning what it was she meant by that. It can't be taught, it has to be lived. And, you know, I would say maybe even more than with my other subjects, I kind of went in and out of a feeling of closeness and then sometimes dismay and then reaffirmation of my passion for her. She had, as many of you know, an alcohol problem, and this is something that comes up in my own little memoir. I had a father who was an alcoholic, and everybody has a parent who's an alcoholic, probably. I don't know. Not people whose parents are here. Many people's parents are here. I'm just saying, that's kind of an ordinary thing. But anyway, I don't have a lot of patience for alcoholics, put it that way. You know, this the predictable things would happen. Relationships would fall apart. I often found myself feeling for the person who was having difficulty with Elizabeth Bishop. But I think that was another function for these memoir passages. I could sort of work out my own feelings about that. And I was very concerned not to hold this against her. Whatever it was that she was the person that made these poems that I love and we all love. And who was I to judge in any way? And I've been glad to hear from people with experience of alcohol that they think I handled that well. So thanks for the question. Anyone in the back?
Hi. Can you talk a little bit about how her papers came to Vassar and some of the sensitivities with writing the biography for somebody that was so private?
Yes, that's a great question. The bulk of her papers were sold to Vassar College shortly after her death by Alice Methfessel, her partner. I think she'd actually hoped they would be sold to Houghton Library. But they didn't offer as much, probably to their regret. So I think she died, and their regret now. But they did end up with Emily Dickinson. So Amherst is sorry about that, I think. Anyway, But the Amherst does have some things. Sorry, what, Christine?
Who's keeping score?
Yeah. And who's keeping score? The papers survive. That's the main thing. But I think, so, you know, there were many, many drafts of poems, lots of letters, great material on which other biographies have been written. But you may be referring to this recent cache of letters, the trove. And of course, you know, my experience with those letters kind of coincided with my own effort to move from being student and thinking of Elizabeth Bishop always as Miss Bishop. It took me quite a while to lose that title. I remember asking Lloyd, what should I refer to her as when we speak of her? You know, I just had trouble getting out of Miss Bishop. And it was then that I was reading the letters to her psychoanalyst, which we really don't know, you know, whether she even mailed them to the psychoanalyst. They constitute a kind of, I mean, it's just not infrequent in psychoanalysis that the patient would be asked to write a kind of life history, and this is what this is, and it's full of, you know, her early sexual experiences, an uncle who was abusive, but also great material about several poems that she either was working on then or later worked on. So they're quite valuable, I think, from that point of view alone. But I came to a certain point in these letters and I just felt these were things that she would not have wanted people to read or to know. And I started to cry thinking about Miss Bishop. And I thought, you know, these letters, maybe, I mean, I would never have predicted that I would have such a feeling, but it occurred to me to contact Jonathan Galassi, who's the director of Forest Strauss Giroux, which manages the rights, and to ask him to remove them or destroy them. And I sort of felt that way for a couple of hours, or maybe less than an hour, but I realized, you know, the reason I knew about them was that someone else working on these letters had told Lloyd about them, and Lloyd told them to me, and so, you know, it was too late. It was too late. And I felt very strongly that then it was my responsibility to use them carefully, and to find out. One of the things I spent a lot of time doing was to learn everything that I could about Ruth Foster, the psychoanalyst, because if these letters were going to be featured in my book, I needed to know who she was writing to, what the relationship was like to the extent I could, or what person she was, you know, writing to with such affection and openness. She really adored, at least at the time of writing these letters, Ruth Foster. And in fact, as Heather has written about, Heather Treseler has written about a series of drafts of poems that Elizabeth Bishop wrote to Dr. Foster, and they survived in the first, you know, batch of papers. And Dr. Foster was working on a paper on color, the colors in dreams, and that is sort of a theme of these draft poems. And she wrote to Robert Lowell about a psychoanalyst friend who was working on this paper. Bishop was fascinated by this idea. And one of the things I really wanted to find out was Ruth Foster, who was a bit older than Elizabeth Bishop, maybe 10 or 12 years, died in 1950, died young. And from the obituary that I found, she appeared to be living alone. And I wanted to know, how had she died? I couldn't just say she died and Elizabeth Bishop was very upset. You know, it seemed ominous. So I did find out it was not a suicide, but this was a lot of work and but very rewarding. So it's a long answer to your question about using this material. I knew other people would use it. I wanted to get my version out so that I could kind of maybe set a standard of how this would go. I didn't manage to beat one person who wrote a kind of sensational article in the Yale Review, which actually, as it turned out, had misinformation in it, because I was able to you know, be sleuth-like and find out some other things. So anyway, if you read the Yale Review article, don't believe everything you read there. So anyhow, it's very complicated, and I think I do think that someone of this nature can survive whatever is out there. Her poems are surviving, and knowing the intimate life of a poet who wrote intimate poems, not in the sense of being confessional the way many of her peers were writing, but ones that draw in the reader, that you feel close to her through the poems. In the end, it didn't seem wrong to me to use this material, and if I didn't, someone else would, so I did the best I could. Thanks. Maybe one last question, if there's another question. Yeah.
Hi, I was just curious, to what extent do you use other secondary sources or other biographies in your own work versus primary sources?
That's a very good question. I mean, I think it's really important to know what's out there, and to with all of my books, I do a kind of, you know, deep dive of reading into what's been written about my subjects, and then I try to put it out of my head as much as possible. And then later I'll do a kind of check to make sure I didn't inadvertently plagiarize something, which can happen. I mean, you know, for example, Margaret Fuller's parents met as they were walking across the bridge to the Cambridgeport Bridge. And, you know, maybe I happened to say that in exactly the same way some other biographer did. I was worried that I would. So that kind of thing I'll check. But one thing I have to confess I did not do very much of, I didn't read very much critical writing about Elizabeth Bishop's poems. I didn't read, there was a book by Colm Toybean about Elizabeth Bishop's poetry, how it was kind of more, a sort of combination of memoir and appreciation of the poems. And I was very much afraid that my sense of the poems would be sort of jogged off course by reading too many critical interpretations, although I liked very much Helen Vendler's writing about The Moose, one of Bishop's great poems, and I remembered that from long ago. I didn't read Heather's article about Ruth Foster's, the Ruth Foster drafts, until just now, actually, and I'm very glad to read it now. But anyway, I think it's you need to be responsible about it, but you also don't want to get sort of, infected by someone else's point of view or version of things. And what really matters is engaging with the primary sources and seeing the connections that you can find. And as you heard from the very first clip, you know, it's when you hear something that you think no one has heard before, or read something you think no one has read or understood in the same way, seen the same way that you did, that that kind of spark of urgency is what gets the book written. So thanks for your question, and thanks for coming. Hope you'll read the book. Thank you.